So for those of you that don't know me, about 8 years ago I started a website called Bigfoot Diaries. I mostly built it for myself because I felt like out there was not a lot of current news. So if a local station picked up a piece of information where someone saw a Bigfoot crossing the highway, not everybody in the world was able to have access to that information. So it's basically a news source. And I built it for myself. I'm a web developer. And what I didn't realize is that other people were hungry for it too. So what ended up happening is it kind of took off. It allowed me to meet other people in the Bigfoot community. And that's when I realized that what was most important to me is not so much about Bigfoot, but the community itself. So I cared so much about the community and I felt like I need to contribute to it. So I did a thing called Hopscotch. Any Hopscotchers out there? It's a monthly Bigfoot beer speaker series that I do in Portland, Oregon. And one of the things is, and I'll admit it, I was jealous. I was jealous that Ohio, Texas, all these guys had better social organizations than we did in the Pacific Northwest. And I felt like Bigfoot belonged to us in Northern California. Thank you. Thank you. Right? Bigfoot's ours, right? So one of the things I was hoping to do is bring everybody from Northern California all over to Washington and kind of create a community. And I'm happy to say that next year is our fourth year of Hopscotch. You can find it online through two S's. And I encourage you guys to come visit. So, Bigfoot, beer, equals God. So, when I say Bigfoot in a box, it's a little bit shocking. I'm not a big fan of killing Bigfoot, and that's not exactly what I mean. Sometimes when you put something in a box, you're categorizing it, right? So that's really what I mean. How do we put Bigfoot in a box? How do we come up with a better model of Bigfoot, right? Because right now, when you try to categorize Bigfoot, you have to go to the bookstore where the unicorns are, where the fairies are, leprechauns, vampires, werewolves. All cool. But even as a second grader, I knew that Bigfoot was different.
So you're asking,
I knew that Bigfoot
camera away?
Was one of these fantastic creatures that didn't require magic. That Bigfoot was in the category of all sudden. And so even though people talk about Bigfoot in the fantasy box, that's what's my appeal about Bigfoot. Okay. Is Bigfoot was plausible. He could be a physical creature that doesn't require magic. So that was the box that I put in. I wanted Bigfoot to be real. I wanted to investigate further. Because even though most of the world thinks Bigfoot is a fantasy creature, I like that Bigfoot could be real. Now, I don't know how many of you guys are familiar with the inkblot test. It's also called a Rorschach test. As I got further and further into the Bigfoot community, I realized that Bigfoot was kind of like an inkblot test. People would project what they thought Bigfoot was into what they saw. This is a random test. If you guys see Bigfoot in here, you guys are in the right place. It's totally just random inkblot. There's no Bigfoots in there. Well, I realized that even though Bigfoot was something that we all categorized together, that we all had the same interest, there's other versions of Bigfoot that we all look at. There's biblical Bigfoots. Enoch, Esau, he's described as having red hair when he was born. And then there's also some people that think that Cain was the first Bigfoot. And there's actually well-documented Mormon documentation that talks about Cain as being the first Bigfoot. There's also the Native American spirit. The Native American spirit Bigfoot, the wild men, the warning whistles. Bigfoot was the boogeyman if you weren't behaving. If you were a young Indian and you didn't eat your vegetables, watch out for Bigfoot. Then there's the sci-fi Sasquatch. People think Bigfoot's an alien. They think there's a kind of genetic mutation. And there's a dimensional shape-shifting psychic monster. Now somebody asked me why I added monster to that, especially the ones who believe that Bigfoot can shapeshift and is psychic. And so they said, why does it have to be a monster? Anything that can change its shape and get inside my head is scary, right? So that's why I added a monster to it, but not necessarily evil. So where is Bigfoot? Is Bigfoot all those things? We don't know. Nobody has a monopoly on the truth. But my approach to Bigfoot, I think, is a little bit unique. I think Bigfoot is more like dinosaurs, right? So if you think about it, paleontologists, they know they're never going to see a dinosaur. Jurassic Park doesn't count. Jurassic World doesn't count. And the other thing about paleontologists is, at one point, they thought dinosaurs were these reptiles, and their tails drug on the ground, and they were cold-blooded. But because paleontologists build better models of what they think dinosaurs are over time, they come up with better representations of what dinosaurs are. And I encourage that for Bigfoot. I think that's a piece that may be missing. I think we can build better models of Bigfoot based on the different categories, based on everybody's research. And we can have multiple models of Bigfoot. So I also think that we shouldn't give up on science. So I think there's some people that think that that science has already done as much as it can. But I remind you guys that paleontologists, when they thought they were reptiles, just within the, and they thought they were reptiles for centuries, just within the last four decades or so, they realized that dinosaurs were not cold-blooded. They realized that their pelvises might have been turned to a certain degree, and they realized that their tails didn't slide on the ground, that they actually used them as counterweights. So after centuries of scientists with tons of money, tons of backing from universities, they didn't get it correct, but they kept on trying. So I wouldn't give up on science yet. We now think that dinosaurs might be multicolored. Some of them might even have plumage. And we know they're closer related to birds than they are to reptiles. And this is what I mean. So just recently, Dr. Meltram created a 3D printed representation of a Bigfoot skeleton. And now we can build flesh on top of it, and now we can try to make some better guesses. And I won't go too far into it, but one of the things he realized is there were things, after he built that model, they learned about how the neck works on a Sasquatch that totally blew them away. And mostly about how the way people describe the silhouette of Bigfoot makes so much more sense now, because based on the skeleton that they built, he realized that it was definitely hunching forward. So paleontologists do this all the time. Bones, muscle, and they come up with a better representation. And this is what happened when they realized that just moving the pelvis a certain degree changed their whole paradigm of how dinosaurs work. We can do that with Bigfoot. This looks very much like a Bigfoot. This is actually an Ardipithecus. She existed 11 million years ago. But these are the things that I want to do. I want to help provide inspiration so we can do the same thing for Bigfoot. So we can treat Bigfoot as a paleontology. Because I think I'm a little bit different when I say that I really am okay if I never see a Bigfoot. I mean, obviously I hope to. It would be fantastic. I've always wondered what their nose shape is like. But I'm okay with just building better models of Bigfoot. I think that's a good place to start. So even though I'm a fan of science, even science has its own biases, right? And so I think it's also, if we understand that where science comes short, it also gives us a better ability to accept what's happened so far and why science has come short. They have what was called the single species hypothesis, meaning someone who is as smart, as brilliant, and can make tools like a bipedal hominid would dominate their environment. There wouldn't be enough room for someone else to compete. So for the longest time, they didn't even think there could be another bipedal human. They thought only one could dominate their whole environment. And that created bias. And that's one reason why science, just within the last couple decades, have not been open to maybe there being other hominids out there. Well, eventually they realized there were other hominids out there, right? In fact, there were 6 hominids that shared the planet at one time, for quite a span of time. Dr. Jeff Meldrum said at one point, Earth was literally the planet of the apes. And with this new information, now they're starting to realize that there may be a chance there are other hominids that existed at one time. There may be other hominids out there today. So I'm sure a lot of you guys get asked, well, do you really believe in Bigfoot? And I get asked that all the time. And my answer is, I tell people I'm a Bigfoot hopeful. I hope Bigfoot's out there. I want to believe Bigfoot's out there. I haven't had an encounter myself, but I am hopeful. I think that's important. One of my favorite quotes is, if I have seen further, it is by standing on the shoulders of giants. Right? When Isaac Newton first wrote that, everybody thought he was being humble. This is the guy that described how planets work. We couldn't put a man on the moon or robots on Mars without his mathematics. And he said that it was by standing on the shoulders of giants is what allowed him to be as smart and come up with the mathematics that he has. And it was being humble. But actually it was Bernard Chartres, a 12th century philosopher that came up with that term. And what we have here is a Greek mythology. This is a blind giant with a dwarf sitting on top of him. The phrase is actually about the giant using the help of a dwarf to see beyond the horizon. The actual Latin is namus gigantum humerus incidentes. Dwarves sitting on the shoulders of giants. Originally, this was not supposed to be humbling, it was actually instruction. In order to see past your own horizon, you need to have the help of people that are smaller than you. Someone who's the next generation. So I'm hoping to do that. But first, let's identify a couple of giants. You'd be surprised, some of you, how many young Bigfoot researchers don't know some of the people that started all of this. Bernard Hulmer, father of cryptozoology, on the track of unknown animals. If you guys don't know this guy, write his name down, Google him, learn all you can about this man. The giant before him, the shoulders that Hoveman stood on, was Ivan T. Sanderson. He is the absolute trailblazer. He was one of the first guys that wrote and speculated that there might be dinosaurs out there today. And if you don't know this name, Ivan T. Anderson, he is absolutely the forefront person that you should be Googling and learning about. We wouldn't be here today unless we knew about these two guys. But there's some other giants that have nothing to do with Bigfoot that I'm going to talk about. So, in my day job, when I'm not looking for Bigfoot, I have to do predictive analytics. I have to predict whether or not a coat is going to sell in Georgia or New York or Florida. And then I have to predict for this company what color that coat is going to be. I do this for several companies. And predicting Bigfoot using data, I think, is the next step. We have plenty of data, but we're not doing with it what we should be doing, what we could be doing, I should say. We're not visualizing it. We're not visualizing the data. We have BFRO, we have John Green's database. We have other people that are doing their own independent research, putting pins on a map. And that's great, but we need to visualize this data. So let me show you the power of what visualizing data can do. So on Facebook, you can go on there and you can tell them to search all the words that you've ever used on Facebook, and they make this word cloud out of it. This happens in your mind. Obviously, I talk about Bigfoot a lot. Second thing I talk about is myself. I was surprised and not surprised. But instantly, it would take me longer to explain what this is than for you guys to automatically know what it is, right? So if I was to explain, well, it takes a lot of words and it makes the biggest count of the most amount of words and makes that word bigger than all the other words, and so you can see at a glance what my favorite topics are. And if you got some of you guys know me a little bit better, you know that I have a squirrel and I love it. It's stuffed, it's not real, but I still love it. And it loves me back. So, who's the giant when it comes to visualizing data? Not this Jon Snow. This Jon Snow. Alright? So if any of you guys have been in an operation and you've been able to sleep through the whole thing while they cut you up, it's because of this guy. He's one of the first anesthesiologists. But he also did something even more important. He figured out how to solve the cholera outbreak in London back in 1854. So he also collected data, but he did something different with it. He visualized it. And he used amazing technology that was available to him back in 1854. It's called pen and paper. So this is a map of London. And let's just zoom in here. So each one of these black bars represents a death from cholera. Now back then they didn't know how cholera got people sick. They didn't know why people were dying. They thought cholera was something that people were dying from breathing the air. And since you don't have a way to control the air, you have no way to control this outbreak. And people were panicking, people were scared. He decided to create a map. He didn't just collect data, he visualized it, right? He made a mark for everywhere people were dying. Notice there's a big grouping right here. And use the red circle to show you that red circles can also be used for other things than blurry Bigfoot pictures. They can be used for presentations at the Sasquatch Summit. So do you see this big grouping right here? And right in the center of that grouping is a pump. Water. This was the first time that they realized that diseases could be spread by the water you were drinking. They didn't know this until as recently as 1854. The other thing that he found out, which is also just as amazing, especially since I like beer, is there was a brewery right next door, and notice there's no black marks there, right? So I know there's kids here, I'm not saying that beer is good for you, but beer is good for me. So what did that mean? Not only now do we know that there's no people getting, that all the people who are getting sick are around this water pump, and that if you looked at all the other water pumps in London, that's where people were getting sick. But the people who drink beer don't get sick, right? All from visualizing data. He didn't just have a bunch of numbers, he put it on a map using technology called pen and paper. And what they later realized is the fermentation process of brewing beer killed the bacteria and all the things that cause cholera. So right now, this is what we're doing with Bigfoot data. You have three states, and you have a number next to them. Even if we use Jon Snow's solution of putting a black bar next to each one, at least now you get some context, right? It's not just a number. You can see, oh, Washington has it going on. If we were to change states, and we saw that Washington was growing, we could start seeing trends, right? But what if we could take that a step further? What if we could color code these things? Visuals, audios. That we, not only does Washington have going on, but they have twice as many as California audio recordings. Probably because of what David Ellis is doing over there, right? Oregon, now these aren't accurate numbers, but Oregon in this example sadly has no audio. But what if we could take that a step further? What if each of these encounters that people put into a map were smart? What if they were self-aware? What if we asked these guys to organize themselves based on whether they were visual, audio, or whether their footprints left behind? Now we have a visual representation, and this is somewhat what you would expect, but maybe when these numbers get bigger, we can find out where the most audio is happening, where the most visuals are happening, where the most evidence is. So let's just take an example. In visualizing data, we call this a heat map. Meaning the darker the colors, the hotter the action, right? So this is the world. Looks like all the action is happening right here in North America, right? So let's click on North America. All right. Well, it looks like we've got some action in Texas. Maybe somewhere in Florida. California is definitely hot. But we want to find out what's happening in Washington. Let's click on Washington. Boom. Instantly, all you guys know exactly what's happening in the state of Washington, where the best action is for visuals, for audios, and where most of the just generic. And then colors of the circles and the shape that they are tell you how much more action there is. So not only is this a heat map for the state, but also by size you can see a representation of what's happening in Bigfoot research and where all the action is happening in the state. So we have technology that can do this. It's currently in development. MappingBigfoot.com will be available in April. And it's taking the databases not only from BFRO, not only from John Green, but also seven other independent databases. And it's going to visualize Bigfoot for everybody. And this is one of the things that's important to me, is I care more about the community than I care about being the one that finds Bigfoot. And I want this to be something that anybody, from a second grader to someone who's been doing research for 50 years, to be able to jump on this website, find out where the hotspots are. And I will be demonstrating this next year at the Ohio conference. And one of the other things I'm really pleased about is we actually have a timeline that you can actually scrub from 1800s to 2000. You can actually see not only migration from locality to locality, but even migrations from altitude to altitude. And I think this is one of the best things that we can do for the Bigfoot community, is to visualize data. To be able to, for people to not be nerds, not be mathematicians, but add plants, contribute to this research, and visualize what is happening with Bigfoot. So you're not just looking at raw numbers, you're looking at relationships, and you're looking at ways that people can actually digest this information at a glance. So I'm going to finish up talking about one more giant. Charles Fort. The other two guys that I mentioned earlier, they call themselves Fortians. Why? Because of this guy. This guy is the absolute guy who started it all. One of his quotes is, all phenomena are approximations one way or the other between realness and unrealness. He investigated anomalous phenomena. And this is why I also think that although we shouldn't give up on scientists, we shouldn't give up on the paranormal people that are doing research too. Because it's still data, and we still need to collect it, and we should still visualize it. Charles Fort used to collect everything. He was found in the New York libraries as writing on little pieces of paper every newspaper article. Everything that was weird, from human combustion, spontaneous human combustion, to weird creatures, to things that science couldn't explain. One of my favorite stories about him is, there's only one story that he thought was not worthwhile. And it was about a talking dog that evaporated in green smoke. The problem we have with that is not that it evaporated in green smoke, but he said, dogs can't talk. So, he also collected other things. Nobody knew why. Seashells, feathers. And thank you. They call me Fonzie. So, he collected all these things, and he collected them all in a certain way. He collected them in shoe boxes. He has over 300 shoeboxes full of weird phenomena, including shoeboxes full of seashells and feathers. And so I'd like to say that maybe we can put Bigfoot in a box. I hope all you guys do collect all your information so eventually we can visualize it. So I think that everybody can contribute to Bigfoot research. No matter how much research they do or how little research they do, please collect your data. It doesn't have to be in a computer, it doesn't have to be in a database, it doesn't even have to be on pencil and paper. You can collect it in a box. Remember, this is an instruction, it wasn't about being humble. We're trying to contribute to the generations beyond us. People who are doing research tomorrow, people who haven't found us today. If I've seen further is by standing on the shoulders of giants. Let's become those giants. Let's create great shoulders so other people can stand on them. Thank you, everybody.